For the following special program, MacGyver will not be seen tonight. Stay tuned for a nostalgic look at WJZ's 40 years of broadcasting. 40-something, next on Channel 13. Forty-something is brought to you by the Baltimore Spice Company, the makers of Old Bay seasoning.
The American Broadcasting Company presents the Candid Microphone.
Now to the editorial room of the Jurgens Journal and Walter Winchell.
Good evening, Mr. and Mrs. North and South America, all the ships at sea. Let's go to press.
This is your host, bidding you enter the inner sanctum.
Johnson's Wax Program with Fibber McGee and Molly.
The year was 1948, the month November. President Harry S. Truman was running for re-election against Thomas Dewey, and Tommy D'Alessandro was mayor of Baltimore. You could buy a new car for less than $2,000 and fill it with gas for just three.
Looking through the November 1st edition of the Baltimore Sun that year, many Baltimoreans noticed a small ad announcing the debut of Baltimore's newest television station. The next day at 6 p.m., with the transmission of a simple test pattern, Channel 13 was on the air, and a very important chapter in the history of Baltimore broadcasting was begun.
For 40 years, WJZ-TV, originally known as WAAM, has sat high atop TV Hill, broadcasting to the city of Baltimore and the people of Maryland.
The city has changed, and so has the station. But as we approach 40-something, we realize that the relationship between the station and the people of Baltimore hasn't changed. It continues to be a very special friendship.
Welcome to WJZ-TV. Hello, I'm Al Sanders.
And I'm Denise Koch. Tonight we take a look back at 40 years on Channel 13.
It's impossible, of course, to condense 40 years of television in an hour broadcast. And any attempt can only skim the surface. This retrospective will focus on the highlights.
But first, a little history. We begin at the beginning.
When WAAM, or WAM as it was called, signed on the air November 2nd, 1948, it was Baltimore's third television station. It held the distinction of being the first television station in Baltimore and one of the few nationwide to open shop in a building designed specifically for television.
On June 27, 1957, the sale of WAM to the Westinghouse Broadcasting Company was approved. And in August, the call letters were changed to WJZ.
In 1958, WJZ acquired the rights to Oriole Baseball, an important deal for WJZ and the community. The station carried Oriole Baseball from 1958 to 1960, and again from 1962 to the end of the 1978 season.
In 1959, the Candelabra Tower was built on Television Hill, allowing all three stations to reach viewers in Virginia, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, as well as many Marylanders who were formerly unable to tune in. WJZ has also been a leader in technological advances. In the spring of 1985, Channel 13 became the first commercial television station in Baltimore to broadcast in stereo.
Throughout the years, WJZ has established a solid reputation in broadcasting excellence and has won many national and international awards.
And today, that commitment to excellence continues in both news and programming.
When we return, we'll take a look at 40 years of Eyewitness News.
This important message is brought to you by the Baltimore Spice Company, makers of Old Bay seasoning.
The future of the Chesapeake Bay begins with you. Please, don't let it end like this. Call for a free information packet on how you can help.
Bawk. McDonald's chicken combos at a price worth squawking about.
Heineken. Amstel Light.
This
so
is
much
it.
Better than
it's
other
a great
light beers.
Imported beer.
A delicious
nothing
European
nothing compares
taste,
to the smoothness,
a refreshing,
the richness, or the character
distinctive
of
flavor that cuts through
its
your
quality
thirst.
Comes through.
There's a uniqueness to it.
Heineken is America's number one selling imported beer. Amstel Light is America's number one selling imported light beer. Why? Just ask the people who drink them.
If you ask me, Amstel Light is the best beer there is. I could go on and
say enough about
it. It's a light beer.
No matter how many beers you.
Yeah, these are the free ones.
Free ones?
Absolutely.
It's never been done before.
No, it's not national. It's local. Right. So the odds are good.
Your local Ford dealer is giving away 10 brand new Escorts, along with $500 cash.
Hey, Joe, how about some more of these forms over here?
No purchase necessary. To enter, see your Ford dealer.
I don't have to take a test drive or anything?
Nope.
The Great Ford Giveaway through May 31st. Hurry.
This is a good way to get a new car. I like this.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Channel 13. Happy birthday to you.
Twice every weekday evening, as a member of the Eyewitness News team, I make this journey from the newsroom to the studio to bring you the news. A news operation is only as good as the people behind it, and success comes from years of experience and trust. We take a look now at some of the people who brought you Eyewitness News over the years.
Ladies and gentlemen, elected in his own right, the President of the United States.
The presidential election of 1948 was of particular consequence to Channel 13. The re-election of Harry S. Truman was the first news to be broadcast over its airwaves. Wham's original 15-minute newscast was presented daily at 7 p.m. by Ted Jaffe, with Nick Capafrida on sports.
How does it feel to own an Edsel?
It's like falling in love.
Up in the morning and out to school.
In 1957, the news was expanded to a half hour, and Keith McBee was hired as news director and anchor.
In the early years at Channel 13, it wasn't unusual to find one person doing many jobs. In the early 60s, a young man by the name of Royal Parker, who was hired as a station announcer, also hosted a variety of kids' programs. He often filled in for Keith McBee on the news.
Until tomorrow, when Keith McBee returns, this is Royal Parker, your ESSA reporter, saying goodnight and have a good day tomorrow.
I had the good fortune of being able to do so many things, including that of doing a kiddie show at one moment, and an hour later, taking off the makeup, I was back in as the authoritative and credible newscaster.
In 1962, the big news was the Cuban Missile Crisis.
This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba.
The situation had worsened, and President Kennedy ordered an air and sea embargo on Cuba. It was the year that Johnny Carson was introduced as the host of The Tonight Show. Another young man was introduced to television that year. Originally hired as a staff announcer and news reporter, he would become the most popular personality in the history of Baltimore television. His name was Jerry Turner, and in 1964 he became anchor of Eyewitness News.
If he decided to run, he would be a formidable candidate. Sears admitted, however, that McKeldin's hesitancy in the November election had caused the party some, as he put it, irritation.
When Jerry started delivering the news was often not very pleasant. We've just lost one of the nation's most popular presidents to an assassin's bullet, and the discordant cry for civil rights and racial equality was met with hate and hostility. As American troops marched to North Vietnam, American students marched in protest. The mid to late 60s proved to be a turbulent time for both our city and the nation.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Have you heard from Sonny since you fought him last?
Well, all I heard about Sonny Liston, he got in a lot of trouble out there in Denver, Colorado.
In addition to giving the news, Jerry often liked to go out and get the news. He had a great talent both on the set and on the street.
When you come out of here, how long will you have stayed under a shower?
102 hours.
Well, beside getting wrinkled fingers, can we see? wrinkled fingers and wrinkled feet and wrinkled skin. What other bad effects, if any, have you experienced?
Well, the first night, sleeping was terrible.
In June of 1972, Hurricane Agnes swept the eastern coast of our nation. As Marylanders prepared for the worst, they prayed to be spared and turned to Channel 13 for up-to-the-minute reports on the hurricane's path. Agnes wasn't kind. Her violent winds caused $1 billion in damages.
The worst is over. Most families now have enough food and clothing and at least dry temporary shelter. In October of that year, a young man from St. Louis blew into town to do news reporting and to anchor the weekend edition of Eyewitness News.
Al Sanders, Channel 13, Eyewitness News. In 1976, as America was celebrating the country's bicentennial, Eyewitness News became the first news in Baltimore to expand to an hour, and WJZ became the first station to employ a full-time consumer reporter and investigative team.
Jerry Turner's been one of your favorite newsmen for years. Al Sanders has been one of your favorites on weekends. Now Al joins Jerry for Eyewitness News at 6 on Channel 13.
In the spring of 1977, I joined Jerry as co-anchor of the 6 o'clock weekday edition of Eyewitness News.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Jerry Turner.
And I'm Al Sanders.
That outbreak of typhoid fever in Maryland has now...
For 25 years, Jerry Turner anchored Eyewitness News. Baltimore loved Jerry, and Jerry loved Baltimore. He is fondly remembered for what perhaps was his favorite part of the newscast, The Kicker. That last story before the goodbye that left the viewer with a smile.
Well, finally, ladies and gentlemen, it is not a pretty story.
All I had to do to Turner would be off camera and go, he'd start reading the story. And finally, tonight in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, all I had to do is go, uh-oh. Now, that doesn't sound like that's funny, and it's not. But to Turner, it meant that he knew that I knew something was coming up, and he'd start to laugh and giggle. And before you know it, he was kind of, sometimes he would get so silly, you never even heard the punchline of the story.
But Tracy Waters, an Oklahoma teenager, owes her life to pigeons. She was climbing on a rooftop when it collapsed, and she fell 5 stories down an elevator shaft. Escaped with only a few bruises and a lot of embarrassment. The fire chief said her fall was cushioned and her life saved by a 5-foot pile of pigeon droppings at the bottom of the elevator shaft. I'm Jerry Turner. Good night.
That's great.
Good evening. I'm Al Sanders.
And I'm Denise Koch.
Tonight, the news is very painful for us to share with you. Our friend, Jerry Turner, is dead. He died at 7:15 tonight. He was 58.
On New Year's Eve, 1987, this city and this station lost a very special friend, and an important era in the history of WJZ came to a close.
This important message is brought to you by the Baltimore Spice Company, makers of Old Bay seasoning.
The future of the Chesapeake Bay begins with you. Please, don't let it end like this. Call for a free information packet on how you can help.
Not very long ago, America introduced Pepsi to the Soviet Union. And while it may be just a coincidence, a lot of refreshing changes have taken place ever since. Pepsi, a generation ahead.
Have you ever thought about being a pilot? Just think how much fun it would be. Why, a plane can take you all kinds of places.
and land almost anywhere. Now they've landed at Roy Rogers. Planes, jets, helicopters, even an airport and runway. And there's one in every Roy's kids meal. No wonder so many people are dropping in.
Et voilà, le pig.
Let me guess, burgers and fries?
Wrong hotel.
What?
I trust you brought your own high chair.
Hey,
what kind of a...
Shh, shh. Maitre d' gets very upset if you raise your voice.
You guys should have stayed at Holiday Inn. They've got great stuff for kids, pizza, pools, games. You're better than this place.
But since you're here, may I suggest the eels flambé?
Why take chances? Stay with someone you know. Holiday Inn.
I am not Al Sanders. I am Kurt Schmoke, the mayor of the city of Baltimore. Happy birthday, Channel 13.
This is the newsroom where the members of the Eyewitness News team work to bring you the news each day. It takes a lot of people, both in front of the camera and behind the scenes, to put on close to 20 hours of news a week. Many of the reporters who have come and gone over the year, I'm sure you're familiar with lots of the anchors you remember. There is one young man who is still working here, who has been here for the last 29 years. I know you know this young man as George Bauman. George, can you tell me what it was like up here on Television Hill 29 years ago when you arrived?
Well, you just saw how big the newsroom is. So many people, I don't really know everybody here. Back then, we had about six people in the newsroom, in a room about the size of, a little bigger than the area we're sitting in right now.
What are the kinds of stories you've covered in this state over 29 years? A lot of changes.
Oh, a lot of changes. Political trials, we had a lot of those. All of the political conventions going back to 1960. Lots of governors, lots of mayors, lots of county executives. The social upheaval of the 60s, which began down in Cambridge, worked through Princess Anne and up into Baltimore. All of those things.
It's a lot of changes. And now we're going to take a look back, George, at Eyewitness News and how it's changed over the years.
There were no fancy opens in the early days of Eyewitness News, just a small staff with low-budget sets. It was all quickly processed black-and-white film, which sometimes broke on the air. That often produced post-newscast temper tantrums. That's a young George Bauman. 13's first weather person was Claire Beach. She and George were the original anchors of the midday news. As the Eyewitness News team began to grow in the late 60s, Ann Bishop was hired as a reporter and anchor. She was one of Baltimore's first female newscasters. Today, Ann is anchoring the news in Miami.
I was there during the riots and watched sadly as the city was torn apart. The military troops camped in Druid Hill, and I was kept in the armory reporting hourly on the fires. I can only say that turbulent period must have strengthened the Monument City.
The early 70s brought Kay Montgomery. She has since left the business.
Union and management officials for the coal industry are meeting with federal...
The late Wiley Daniels was Baltimore's first black anchorman and reporter.
Baltimore City delegates say they will introduce...
Oprah Winfrey joined Eyewitness News in 1976 as a co-anchor and reporter. Richard Scheer joined us in 1975. Richard and Oprah co-anchored the new news for a while, and Richard often shared the desk with Jerry. He was on the set the night of Channel 13's funniest moment on the air, the Hanukkah live shot.
Standing by at his home, live with instant eye, is Rabbi Bradley Bleifeld of the Baltimore Hebrew Congregation with his family. Rabbi Bleifeld, this is Richard Scheer, and we'd like you to explain the significance of Hanukkah, if you would.
This begins our eight-night festival of religious freedom. We commemorate the time over 2,000 years ago when a small group of Jews fought for their religious freedom against the Assyrians. We of the Jewish community share in the concern for the hostages being held in Iran, for they too are suffering under a contemporary form of religious tyranny.
Well, we certainly hope that all of those prayers are answered, and may all of us here wish you and all of your family a very happy holiday, Rabbi.
Thank you, and to all in the community.
Okay, thank you very much. Still ahead, the Colts prep for the last game of a painful season. Klaus Wagner has that story.
And it's tip-off time at Archbishop Curley. Klaus Wagner will have that story for you live next on Eyewitness News.
Don Scott joined Eyewitness News in 1974. He was beardless at the time. And when Marty was hired in 1977, he had a little more hair.
Marty, for the 40th anniversary, we've been looking at a lot of tape over the years, and every time I take a look at you, you look different. Different color hair, let's put it that way, different hairstyle. When do you decide to show the real you, and why?
The only motivation behind it was that it was never my idea. I never enjoyed wearing that. You know, when I was right out of college, the infamous consultants that you hear about, in any business, not just TV, you know, the same people that say, you must wear red. Okay? You know, that philosophy. They said, you know, wear a hairpiece, you will not work in TV. And I hadn't lost my hair then. It was thinning. They said, do it right now. Now, you know, I'm right out of college, you want to get a job. And it was a move that I regretted literally on a daily basis after that. And finally, I just said, look, I'm not going through another summer wearing this.
A meteorologist, Jim Smith, was Channel 13's first professional weatherman back in the 60s. Today, he does the weather in Tampa, Florida.
I want to say to the people of Baltimore, thank you very much for some very fond memories back in the 60s. And thanks to you, WJZ, for a good time, and happy anniversary to you all.
When Jim Smith left, the station decided to hold open auditions to find their next weathercaster, and the rest is history.
Weather auditions, take one.
Good evening, girls.
Next.
We bring you the weather.
Cut it.
Don't we, Leroy?
Oh, yeah.
The Eyewitness News team saw a lot of weathermen.
The Rockies. Hey, if you're unhappy with the weather.
Oh, until they found the right one.
Hi, I'm Bob Turk. We had a rainy day in Baltimore today, but tomorrow looks sunny.
Hey, hold it. He's really good. Weatherman Bob Turk. It takes a special kind of man for the Eyewitness News team.
Why does it rain when I play golf?
When I originally applied for the job, I didn't even know it was for an on-air position. I thought it was just going to be doing the research because no one was on the air at that time. I thought I'd be doing the forecast for someone just to read on the air. Little did I know, a week later, they said, how'd you like to come in and do the 11 o'clock news with Jerry Turner? And I said, you mean on the air? I said, okay, I'll try it. We'll do it.
But you and Jerry hit it off right away.
We hit it off like father and son immediately. And we've had so many good times. I mean, I can remember some of the funny things that happened. One night on a recap, we had a steering wheel sitting in the studio. I just picked it up as I was doing the weather. I'm sitting there driving this steering wheel, and our audio guy and in the control room, they saw what was going on, and they immediately said, okay, let's get some music, let's put this to music, let's do something with this bit. And I'm listening and I'm playing this driving my car into weather thing. I hear this crash music, all this kind of stuff, and they flip the video upside down, and there I am, upside down, with this, and my hair went back. What a mess. Let's look at our forecast, quickly.
John Kennelly, now reporting sports in New York City, was WJZ's sportscaster during Baltimore's golden age of sports.
65 to 72. The Orioles got into four World Series, won two of them. Colts went to a couple of Super Bowls. The Bullets got into the playoffs in those magnificent struggles with the Knickerbockers two or three times.
After John Kennerly, there was Nick Charles. He's now at CNN. Andrea Kirby, Baltimore's first female sportscaster, joined us in the early 70s.
Even though I went on to the network after I left Jay-Z in 1977, my very best times were at Channel 13. So happy anniversary, WJZ, and thanks for the memories.
Klaus Wagner did sports in the late 70s, and Gail Gardner joined us in 1980. She's now with NBC. Gail shared the sports desk with Randy Blair until his untimely death in 83. Randy was followed by Lou Tilly, who is now at KYW, our sister station in Philadelphia. One night, Lou was doing the sports live from the Civic Center. We had a picture, but no sound.
Show me how many fingers, how many scores the Blast had.
He can hear us!
Blast had five.
And the Steamers.
And the Steamers had three.
Three.
All right.
Four, right?
Okay. You're doing a wonderful job so far, Lou.
Many have been part of the Eyewitness News team over the years. Names and faces have often changed, but one thing has remained the same. We've always been family.
After all, you're only as good as the people you work with.
Thanks.
When we return, we'll take a look back at some of the many TV shows you've enjoyed on Channel 13 over the years.
Move over, candy, no sugar, please. Move over, munchies, I'm ready for cheese. I'm ready for the taste of taste that's driving me crackers. Those Moontown Snackers, those Moontown Snackers.
100% natural cheese snacks, individually wrapped to stay fresh.
Those Moontown Snackers, those Moontown Snackers.
From Sargento of Wisconsin.
At Shell, we've been taking good care of cars for a good long time. And while cars have changed, our philosophy has stayed the same. That's why today, every Shell Auto Care dealer guarantees his work with a nationwide warranty. And because Shell Auto Care is one of the largest networks of car repair centers, you'll never have to worry about finding someone who will take good care of your car for a good long time. So don't take chances. Take it to Shell Auto Care.
Now that Big Boy's Barbecue Bar is back, salesmen have to be pretty creative to sell backyard grills.
It likes a lot of sun. It attracts a lot of birds. It's very educational.
It's so much easier to get all the ribs and chicken you can eat at the Barbecue Bar at Big Boy. Why cook out when you can go out?
It improves reception dramatically.
Finding just the right family car can be a challenge. But consider this. The Mazda 626 has more standard features than a Honda Accord. Its no-deductible bumper-to-bumper warranty is unequal. The 626 is not only hundreds less than Accord, but right now you also get $750 cash back. And it's so much fun to drive, you could almost forget it's a family car. Well, almost.
See your local Mazda dealer today and get $750 cash back on 626.
Good evening, Baltimore. I'm Joan London.
And I'm Charles Gibson. And from all of us at Good Morning America, we'd like to say congratulations.
That's right. Happy 40th anniversary, WJZ, Channel 13.
And go Orioles. O-R-I, etc., etc.
This is the original Channel 13 studio. When it was built back in 1948, it was one of the largest television studios on the East Coast. Television was in its infancy in those days. And Channel 13 was a pioneer in its evolution.
WAAM Top Power 13, Baltimore.
When WAAM signed on the air in November of 48, there were only 43 television stations in the country. TV audiences jumped 4,000% that year, and manufacturers couldn't make sets fast enough to meet the demand. America was mesmerized by this magical box.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, introducing America's number one television star, who, like Lady Godiva, horses around every Tuesday night, Milton Berle!
There weren't many programs available on the networks in those days, and even though there were only about 6 hours of television a day, the pioneers at WAAM had to be creative and produce many of the shows that filled the airtime.
The one thing that you had going for you, that the public were, at that time, were not very sophisticated about television. You had to make up your own show, so to speak. We did a lot of studio shows live in those days.
This Is Your Zoo was one of WAAM's longest-running programs. Premiering in 1949, it ran for 10 consecutive years and made TV stars out of several of the animals.
Now let's join Mr. Arthur Watson and your animal stars on This Is Your Zoo.
We started out with Babs, who's a little dwarf baboon born at the zoo. And her specialty was wearing fancy clothes that a neighbor lady made for her. And became quite famous because in the middle of the show, she'd do a strip tease and the kids would just love it. Betsy was the famous painter. I would throw the colors on and she would mix them, and she took to it beautifully.
The Johns Hopkins Science Review, presented by Johns Hopkins and WAAM in Baltimore, in cooperation with the Dumont Television Network.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another Johns Hopkins Science Review.
The most noted show that came out of Wham, however, was the Johns Hopkins Science Review. It debuted in 1949 and ran for many years, both locally and nationally.
Come on, you can get on free. And so can all of you out there every Monday through Friday at 4:55 on TV 13.
In the spring of 1957, during the final months of Wham!, another kiddie show was born. It helped launch the career of one of Baltimore's favorite television personalities, and it was called Mr. Pop Lolly.
No, what's not my name?
We came up with Mr. Pop Lolly, who would be conductor of a Cartoonerville trolley and would make a circuitous route for 60 minutes, making these stops as we would show these cartoons.
When Westinghouse took over the station in 1957 and Wham! Became WJZ, changes were made in programming.
In addition to the hiring of Keith McBee to run the news operation, Jack Wells, a local radio personality, was hired to do a live morning talk show.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad flags on.
It was also at this time that another local radio personality came to Channel 13 to do a music show. His show would become the most popular local program in the history of Baltimore, and his name was Buddy Dean.
Okay, here is the big dance of this season. Al Brown and his version of The Madison.
Hey, everybody, gather round, it's Madison time.
Give me a big, strong line. Make it look real fine.
So the show was important. I wasn't. I was just a guy that played the records. The show was very important, but I was just one part of it. Yeah, I really believe it. No, I'm not modest. In fact, they could have transferred, they'd put somebody else in there. Only thing that I had an advantage on, I was very knowledgeable in records at the time. When I go to Baltimore, somebody says, you need to come back and do that show again. Well, I don't really think it'd work today. I really don't. I wish I could say it would.
Is Miss Nancy saying hello to all the boys and girls here and to all of our friends at home.
1957 was the year that another popular program started airing on WJZ. Originally on WBAL, Romper Room and Miss Nancy moved to Channel 13, where it aired until Miss Nancy left the show in 1964.
All right, Mr. Music, here we go. Boston
Cats, Boston Cats. It really was an attempt to be a kindergarten on television. We did all the things that children were asked to do and taught to do to get ready for the so-called years at big school.
Doing a live show with kids meant success for Romper Room, but it often meant embarrassment for Miss Nancy.
One time I was sitting reading a story, and one youngster raised his hand and said, Miss Nancy, I have to go. Miss Nancy, I have to go, and I'm doing it right now. And the one sitting next to him goes, yeah, and moves over. And the whole place cracked up, you know.
In 1962, a tramp clown named Lorenzo moved to town, and suddenly, all of Baltimore was doing the Lorenzo stomp.
When I first started with Lorenzo, he was supposed to be a sad tramp. But Lorenzo was a little boy, and no little boy is going to be unhappy long. And so he had a variety of moods, and it gave you more leeway. When you do 13, 15 hours a week of television, you've got to have all the freedom you can get. Baltimore was very special because, for some reason, the show, I believe, was more successful in Baltimore than anywhere else.
In 1964, John Bartholomew Tucker came to town to host an early version of People Are Talking. Today, he is the voice of many local and national commercials.
I have worked at a lot of stations since then. If they're listening to me, forgive me, but I found that that was unique. San Francisco wasn't as good. New York stations weren't. It's the best, single best television station I ever worked at in my life.
This is a time of trial and test for all Baltimoreans.
What's going on? What's going on? Yeah, what's going on? What's going on? Tell me.
In 1968, amidst the riots, protests, and sexual revolution, there was a lot to talk about. On Channel 13, they were talking about it with Arnold Zenker on a show called Contact.
Good morning and welcome to the Arnold Zenker Show. Today's guest, attorney William Kuntzler, and now, Arnold Zenker.
We covered a lot of topics that were controversial. It seems to me, in many respects, in fact, that the more television changes, the more it stays the same. Certainly it's raunchier today. I don't think we could have gotten away with some of the language and some of the content in 1968 that you can in 88. But we did child abuse and we did marital infidelity and we did all the shows you commonly see on the air today.
In 1972, talk continued with Larry Angelo. Originally called the Larry Angel Show, it eventually became the Larry Angelo Show before going off the air in 1978.
Good morning.
The interesting thing about doing what was then the Larry Angel Show was the fact that I was given the chance over a period of about 2.5 years to try virtually every format that exists in television. We were doing an anniversary of the Buddy Dean Show, and my producer said, Larry, I can tell you got a kind of Elvis in you that's always been dying to get out. We're going to go whole hog, and you're going to be the hog.
If I were living in South Africa today, I said that I would lead a riot to kill the whites and take over the country.
All right, let's start.
Now, that seems like a far-fetched, unreasonable, and absolutely terrible statement, but it really is not if you sit down and analyze exactly what I've said.
Let me say something to you. There has to be another solution other than blacks killing whites and whites killing blacks.
Well, what is it?
I don't know. I'm not smart enough, and I don't think you are either.
In February of 1977, Square Off premiered, and Saturday nights on Channel 13 have never been the same.
You're accommodating the homosexuals. You're accommodating making excuses for their behavior, which is not only perverted and a slap in the face to the Holy Scriptures.
Perverted.
But you, yes, that's
Peter,
correct.
I think if we followed a lot of people into the bedroom, we'd find some interesting behavior that might stand your hair on end.
Your voyeurism may take you into other people's bedrooms. I'm suggesting to you, Mr.
Lessons
Christian.
Lessons cost extra, Peter.
For almost 13 years, Baltimoreans have had a chance to speak out and sometimes shout out, even scream out their different points of view on different issues. Richard Scheer has held the gavel for all those years.
And lived to tell about it.
Yes, you have. Have you always wanted to call it Square Off?
Well, when we sat down and tried to figure out the concept, and it was on Saturday night, first, we were going to call it Saturday Night at the Fights. And I was going to sit and wear a referee's uniform and put the four contestants in a round ring and just make it like a fight. But we settled on Square Off.
For all these years, Richard, you have held the infamous gavel, and you try and use it to keep order. Have you ever lost control?
I've almost lost control a couple of times. People think it's an act. It really isn't. When everybody's talking at the same time, which is like the same thing that happens in your living room, you know, when everybody's sitting there, you're trying to entertain at home, and everybody starts screaming and yelling, it's impossible. And everybody thinks, because we only have 30 minutes, that their point is more important than everybody else's, so they start screaming and yelling. I've grabbed people, I've hit people with the gavel, but I've never totally lost control.
The fall of 1977 marked the beginning of another long-running show on Channel 13, Evening Magazine. Shot totally on location, it was one of the first locally produced TV magazine programs in the country.
Originally hosted by Dave Sisson and Linnea Anderson, the show was much different than it is today.
In 1980, Tim White joined Linnea, and in 1981, Donna Hamilton joined Tim.
1984, a new open and a new co-host for Donna. Some other faces on Evening over the years include Baltimore's cabbie J.C. Green, Health Tips with Captain Carrot, Travel with Linda Harris, Buffalo George with his own unique view of American culture, and who could forget Chef Tell.
And I see you.
Many who got their start on Evening have gone on to bigger and better things.
Why am I not doing so bad here? Why don't we go down to the store and get some milk?
Laura Charles, now with the Baltimore Sun, was originally with Evening. Denise Cook was once Daring Denise.
For 12 years, Evening has shown us the stars as well as ourselves. It has taken us around the city, the state, and the world. The show has changed many times over the years, and there have been many faces. But one thing hasn't changed. Evening remains Baltimore's only locally produced television magazine. And today the co-hosts are Donna Hamilton and Steve Eggerson.
Here we are.
Yes. Here we are. From the Evening van. What's unique about Evening, it seems to me, there are a lot of magazine shows on television. But it is a locally produced show, so you really do get a sense of the city when you watch Evening.
I think that is the great thing about a show like this, because while you can have stories that come from many different places and be of national interest, we can also do things that pertain only to here, only to Baltimore, and only to Maryland, which is great.
I think that's probably one of the big secrets why Evening Magazine has been around for 12 years. How many programs have come and gone in 12 years? Real People, That's Incredible, The Wonderful World of People. But Evening remains because we're reporting on what's going on in Baltimore and sending those stories across the country to our partners in the Evening Magazine Cooperative. And they're sending us stories, and we can share them with people here.
People are talking today about having a 30-minute orgasm.
In 1978, People Are Talking hit the air with Oprah Winfrey and Richard Scheer. It was to become Baltimore's most successful locally produced talk show. Several combinations of hosts over the years. First, there was Richard and Oprah. Then there was Richard and Beverly, followed by Richard and Linda. Finally, there was just Richard.
Tonight we have a special treat as part of our celebration of the 40th anniversary of WJZ-TV. We're going to bring two people together who spent 5.5 years together right here in this very studio. From Chicago, Oprah Winfrey is joining us, and Richard Scheer is right here. And here they are together again.
Yes, by the miracle of television.
I think it was longer than 5.5, wasn't it, Rich?
Actually, it was August 14th, 1978.
Not that you remember.
Until the day you moved out of here on December 18th, 1970...
83.
When you 83. Thought you might make it in Chicago.
Oprah, what do you remember about when you first arrived at Channel 13 in the very beginning? Do you remember your first memories of Television Hill?
Oh, my God, yeah. I remember that when I first arrived, there were these billboards and there were these commercials about what is an Oprah. And the theme music behind the commercials was from a chorus line. Dun, 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 and then, yep, I remember that.
When did the PAT idea first come together for the two of you to work together?
Well, they just wanted to try it, I guess. We used to say hello very nicely in the newsroom, I think.
Very nicely.
In different corners of the newsroom. And they paired us, and it seemed to work pretty well.
What was the chemistry like in the beginning, though?
It was very good from the very beginning, because I think we always looked at this as a marriage, and so in any marriage you have to give and take. Somebody has to give, somebody takes, somebody gives. And so if you realize that going in as a team, then there's no problem. If you kind of know what your role is, and Richard was always the funniest one, you know, so I was sort of straight woman to him, and I knew that, you know, so I think that's the reason it just really works so well.
I don't think we ever had a major fight.
No, we didn't.
During the time.
No, we didn't.
We had
As a matter of fact, Rich, there was somebody here in my studio audience recently who said, I would, that they worked at the hospital. Remember the night I went to the hospital and then you came to the hospital and you were the only one allowed into the hospital?
That's right.
Yeah.
That was the night you put me down as your next of kin.
Next of kin.
And your blood pressure was high and I had to rub your arm to get
it
down.
And you know why my blood pressure was high? Because we'd done a show on heart attacks that day, and at the end of the day I thought I was having one.
That's right. That's the one thing about the talk show. No matter what we did, you and I always had those diseases that night.
That night.
So what reaction did you have when you did the Chippendale show? You remember the Chippendale show?
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Was that the show where I ended up sitting in Richard's lap or something?
And you jumped out. In fact, there's a clip of that, but you jumped out of your chair into my lap because this guy was shaking more than his arms at you.
I remember. And I was afraid that maybe it was going to come out of that G-string or something. I don't know.
And we did a lot of appearances together, too, and people used to always ask if I was without Oprah or she were without me, and they always thought that we lived together and were together all the time.
Yeah, I heard some of those rumors. I heard when I came here, I was coming here to have your baby.
How is she, by the way? little Ofritchie.
Oh, yeah, I heard all those rumors.
Well, it's good to see that when you get together and talk about it, you mostly end up laughing.
Oh, the rumors were not true. She, in fact, did not have my baby.
Mm. Right. Yeah, let's get that straight.
Well, I'm glad we've got that straight, especially since we're celebrating this prestigious anniversary.
Another important Channel 13 talk show is City Line. Originally known as Sunday Live, it has focused on minority-related issues for 7 years.
Kids write us letters, and we make dreams come true. Welcome to Wonder World.
Kids shows have always been an important part of WJZ's programming. Wonder World, hosted by Bob Turk, and Kids Baffle, hosted by Bob Callahan, are among the more popular in the recent past.
Right now, we're shaking it up with the latest hit from Bill Collins right here on Shake Down.
In 1985, Baltimore was once again dancing on air with the premiere of Shakedown, WJZ-TV's nightclub. From the Sunshine Kid to Pictures in the Sky, when we return, we'll show you some of our favorite Channel 13 promos.
This important message is brought to you by the Baltimore Spice Company, makers of Old Bay seasoning.
The future of the Chesapeake Bay begins with you. Please, don't let it end like this. Call for a free information packet on how you can help.
We've been playing golf together every Saturday for 6 years. So naturally, when somebody needs a new car, I'm their man, right? After all, I am one of the biggest Ford dealers in town. So what happened? Stan buys a new Honda Accord, Earl gets a new Honda Prelude, and last week, Paul drives up in a Honda Civic. You think that's bad? Now they won't even let me keep score.
Our report on new Domino's Pan Pizza.
Deliver Pan Pizza. Great.
I love the crust. Oh, and the toppings and all that cheese.
And I didn't have to pick it up.
So if you want a great pan pizza delivered, you've got to call Domino's Pizza.
Domino's
Pan
Pizza.
New Domino's Pan Pizza. Nobody delivers better.
Delicious vegetable side dishes ready in a snap. Heat them in the microwave in 3 minutes flat. You've never had vegetables faster than that. Introducing Del Monte Vegetable Classics, now in the canned vegetable aisle. Zip, zap.
Hi, I'm Linnea Anderson.
And I'm David Sisson, the original host of Evening Magazine.
Happy anniversary, WJZ-TV.
This is our control room, where many of our shows and promos are a symbol for air. Promos are those little commercial-like announcements which promote our station, our talent, and our programming. The earliest promo we could find is this one, which dates back to 1961.
in Georgia. I wish we were in on it.
I understand we are, Keith.
As a result of one of our promos, Bob Turk became known as the Sunshine Kid. It was so popular, we decided to do it again. Now, here's a look at the original, as well as the updated version, and others that deal specifically with members of the Channel 13 family.
I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. When it's cold outside, I've got the month of May.
Oh, baby.
This is the place.
Keep it running. I'll be right back.
I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. When it's cold outside, I've got the month of May.
Oh, baby.
Bob Turk, talking about Bob Turk, Bob Turk.
How do you catch bass in the morning? It's not as easy as you might think. So the next time you're looking for the morning's most accurate weather forecast, just remember what Marty goes through to get your day started off on the right foot. Marty Bass on the Eyewitness News, Morning Edition. After all, that's what friends are for.
It is something that too often we take for granted. But imagine how dull this world would be without our smiles. And if you think about it, smiling is not only one of the nicest ways to communicate, it's also one of the most effective. At Eyewitness News, we feel that these qualities are as important in a newscast as they are in our lives. So not only do we take our work seriously, we take our smiles pretty seriously too.
Known as image spots, many of our promos over the years have promoted the station as a whole. We have been the station that was a good feeling to know. And that's what friends are for. Now we are pictures in the sky.
It's the little things you do today that make tomorrow bright. It's the extra effort every time that makes it turn out right.
Here today and here tomorrow.
Start the day. A
friendly smile, a certain style that gets you on your way. People you can talk to, sharing points of view. There's loving and there's laughter just waiting here for you.
It's a good feeling. It's a good feeling to know. It's a good, good feeling. Such a good feeling to know.
A smile, a sigh, good friends, good times. Stars that brighten up the sky. A feeling that will come your way. Sunshine on a cloudy day.
It's a good feeling. Channel 13. It's a good, good feeling to love.
Look at all the stars shining through, shining through. Search the constellations for replies. Channel Baltimore. You know we'll see you through. See you through with pictures in the skies.
There are pictures in the skies of Baltimore. Stories of the American dream. Stories of what's coming and what's gone on before. In the skies with Channel 13.
Pictures.
Well, we've opened up our scrapbook for you tonight, bringing back over 40 years of happy memories at WJZ.
As we close, we'd like to introduce you to the man who is going to lead us into the future, our Vice President and General Manager, Jonathan Klein. Jonathan, how do you see our future?
Well, the next 40 years will be a lot different than the last 40 years. We're going to have more cable. We're going to have satellites beaming directly into your house. And the phone company is going to get into the television business. But as long as WJZ remembers what got us here, and that's all the people, the work of the station, and our involvement in the local community, we'll do just great.
Thank you, Jonathan. We hope you enjoyed tonight's program, and we hope you enjoy Channel 13 for many years to come.
Thanks for watching. Good night.
I'd like you to welcome to our program Arlene Joy with the twist in Susie Q.
Never see it on TV. Now watch this. That's our stage manager tonight.
Sit her right up there. Hi, I'm Steve Avison. This is my partner, Donna Hamilton. She's having a conniption fit.
That's next on Evening.
Look at them fly! Look at it!
For 40 years, this is where it all happened at Channel 13. Romper Room, the Buddy Dean Show, the news, commercial spots, people are talking. They were all shot in here. Each show had its own set piece or backdrop, and they all aired live, which meant that anything could happen. And when it did happen, thousands of people were watching.
Forty-something has been brought to you by the Baltimore Spice Company, the makers of Old Bay Seasoning.